so much for joining me this evening for a little while to dip into our history that has shaped our lives. We're a small group tonight, but still plenty of folks to create a special event. We just started, so come on in. We've got a special seat for you right there. Tonight, we are going to discover a man named Charlemagne. I prefer the French version, Charlemagne. Can you all say it in French? Charlemagne. And Magne comes from the Latin magnus, for Latin student. Magnus means, that's right, great, Charles the Great. So here we have another the Great. That's three greats in a row, right? Alexander the Great, Basil the Great, Charles the Great, because we're studying great people. And he was a very special person. He lived shortly after this event. This is the end of Rome, the end of the Roman Empire. And by that I mean the end of civilization. The Roman Empire kept the roads going, had everything under control. They were a little brutal, but they had the Pax Romana. It kept the peace in the world, and then finally it disintegrated, and barbarians, Visigoths and Goths that we've been studying took them over, and things began to fall apart. Imagine living in a world that's nothing but ruins. The world disintegrated. It was the end of civilization. Imagine if all the grocery stores closed, if you couldn't get things anymore. If there were no more schools, education disappeared. This was the world in which Charles the Great, Charlemagne, was born. Everything had fallen apart for hundreds of years. Imagine that. All that had been built up, all that had been discovered was gone, and now we live in the Dark Ages, it's called. Dark Ages. People are just barely managing to stay alive. Nobody's learning anything. They're digging in the dirt to feed themselves. Everything's gone. This was the world in which Charlemagne came to make a difference. All you had was the leftovers of once upon a time, with all the vegetation growing over the ruins. The glory days were gone. Humanity's achievements were gone. And the world was run over by barbarians. Do you all know what barbarians are? Don't know what a barbarian is? Would you like to see what a barbarian looks like? And then you'll know that's a barbarian. What does that look like? Well, they have large axes, for one thing, and they don't look like happy people. Right? Can you see? They were warriors. They lived in the woods and attacked people, constantly causing warfare. Here's another picture of barbarians. That's what roamed the earth. No law and order, everything in chaos. Very dangerous time to live. Even if you could grow some food, they would come by and destroy everything with their horses and their swords. And then comes a fellow named Charles the Hammer, Charles Martel, he's called. This was Charlemagne's grandfather. And he's remembered because he stopped the Saracens, the Muslims, from invading the country of France. As you can see why he's called Charles the Hammer with what he has in his hand. It's not quite a hammer, but he probably used it like a hammer. And he was a very strong, powerful figure, and he stopped a total invasion of what became France. And from that lineage came Charles the Great. This is Charlemagne's daddy. And his name is, in French, it's Pépin le Bref. Pépin the Brief. He was short. Pépin the Short. He was so short that nobody could take him very seriously. Look at that. That's pretty short. He was like 4 feet tall.
Oh my goodness.
Teeny tiny guy. And he was, see that? Look at that. What kind of a king is that? That's the daddy of Charles the Magnificent, Charles the Great. He was his mother, and her name was Bertraca. Nice lady, but in French they called her Berthe au Grand Pied. That sounds nice, doesn't it? Berthe au Grand Pied. You know what it means in English? Bigfoot Bertha. She had big feet. It's true. I couldn't find a drawing of her feet, but trust me, they were big. And thank heavens, Charles got her genes and not Pepin the Short, because he was 6'4". That's taller than 98% of the population now. In those days, nobody was that big. People were starving, malnourished, they didn't grow well, they were sickly, there was plagues all the time. So your average person was 5'5". And here this giant ruled among them. So just his size amazed everyone and made him a natural leader. And Charles had a brother. And when their little short dad died, the two brothers inherited the land. And Charlemagne is the brother, and he got the better portion of the inheritance. So he got more stuff than his 6'4" brother. Can you see a problem there? This was just an average little guy, and his big brother didn't get all the goods. He got them. And not long, you know, the lands and all that were divided. And so guess what happens to him? He died all of a sudden. We're not quite sure how, but it's a pretty good guess that Charles may have had something to do with it. Because that means that Charlemagne ended up owning everything that his father had given them as inheritance. And Charles the Great, there he is. Can you see that? That's a powerful person. He set about deciding to reestablish all that had been lost over the hundreds of years of the Dark Ages. He wanted to reestablish the Roman Empire.
Yes, sir. Is this around what century is this?
This is 750 or so. So we're talking 8th century. So in 410, Rome falls 400 years later. 400 years of ruin and chaos and bloodshed and illness. So he had quite a job to do. And he said about, yes?
A quick question. Maybe the quick answer. Why did Rome fall?
Why did Rome fall? Oh, there's lots of thick books on that. But, you know, I would, the answer that I find most important is that Rome degenerated in every way. You know, Caligula, ring a bell, Nero, all these wretched people. Some theories are that the lead in the water was poisoning their minds, and they were losing their minds. But, you know, everything from evil behavior, you know, the bloodlust of the Colosseums, can I say orgies, you know, all of that sort of thing.
Corruption.
Drunkenness, corruption of the worst kind. In fact, it looked a lot like our civilization is right now. Mm-hmm. That's why it's interesting.
Yeah.
The end of 1,000 years of supremacy looks a lot like today in America. You know, no values, no dignity, no sense of something greater than them. It just collapsed. You know, their armies were filled with mercenaries because nobody wanted to go to war anymore. You know, it was just all lost. And so it rotted from the inside out. And the barbarians had no problem breaking in, taking over, and then not knowing what to do with it. You know? So I think it's a fabulous example of history repeating itself. Sort of a warning. So, Charlemagne, who I will say up front so that it's not completely negative, is considered a saint in the Western world. Okay? He is a saint to the West. We'll find out why. He's not a saint to the East. He spent 45 years doing a lot of that. Mind your waist of 50 military campaigns. That's 50. That's 5 times 10. That's a lot of battles. And thousands of people died while he conquered lands, while he stabilized his new empire. France, Switzerland, Germany, Belgium, all of that. He took over Italy. And as he did so, he made them all Christians, which was his religion. And so, how do you think he made people Christian?
By force.
This is how he would do it. Would you like to be a Christian or would you like to die? Christian, I'll be a Christian. And in one day, among the Saxons, 4,500 people were killed because they would not become Christian. That's 4,500 people. Thousands and thousands. But a friend of mine who is named after him, so thinks he's not so bad, told me, well, that's how everybody did it. You know, so come on, give him a break. It was, you know, we can't really judge him. You might recall that's how Clovis did it, right? The first king of the Franks. I learned this in first grade in France. He lined up his generals. He's standing there with his battle axe in his hand, and he says, you're going to be baptized now, yes or no? And if it's no, you can guess what happens next with the battle axe. That's how they did it. And so he Christianized the pagan world. He unified all the peoples. And that's what we discover with him, is that along with being a mighty warrior, the Franks were among the best of the Germanic tribes. It turns out that Charlemagne was also a very bright mind, a scholar, in fact. He learned to read Greek and Latin. He spoke Latin perfectly. And in those days, with the fall of the empire, Latin itself was disintegrating and turning into vernacular in different places, you know, sort of corrupted languages. So he recreated a language that everybody could communicate with. In those days of the Dark Ages, people bartered, you know, I'll give you an egg for a spoon, I'll give you a chicken for a hat, right? And he created a money system where everybody had the same coins to buy things, to begin to bring order in the chaos. And so making them Christians, giving them one language, giving them one trading system, began to bring order into the kingdom. So because we are here for the children mostly, I want to give them a taste of these facts of history visually. So we're going to watch a little video, and it's pretty simple, but keep in mind that we want our children to see the clothing, the landscape, the drama of this time, of this journey with Charlemagne. So let's take a moment and get a flavor of the world of Charlemagne. So for 45 years, for 30 years solid, that's all he did, was travel and conquer and kill and bring order. So this is a picture of bringing order. This is the Saxons attacking Christians, pagan forces, and Charlemagne conquered the Saxons and forced their leader to be baptized, just like I told you. There's Charlemagne in the movie. Then he called to his court all the scholars, all the best scholars from around his empire, all the teachers, all those who studied mathematics, languages, and in his court he created the Caroline minuscule, one way of writing that everybody would use now. And he created architecture, Carolingian architecture. Civilization rose out of the Dark Ages. And because of his protection of Christians, he was friends with the Pope, and so he goes to Rome. Here's Rome, that's Marcus Aurelius. Here's the Appian Way, on the way to Rome, on Christmas Day, 800 A.D. The story goes that he thought he was just going to Mass, but something happened on that day. Centuries, protectors of the church and kings, all because of Charlemagne, the father of Europe. Through the centuries, see all the different clothes? They were all in the tradition of Charlemagne. That's Charlemagne's throne. And finally, Napoleon, who crowned himself emperor. Pope was supposed to do it, he took it from the Pope's hand. All because of Charlemagne. So these leaders tried to imitate him down to the centuries. Charlemagne, who started it all. Told you he brought education back, he created schools, he had the clergy become educated so they could be teachers, and he pulled all those countries, which had become one empire, out of the mud of the Dark Ages, out of the ignorance, and the illness, and the killing that was going on for hundreds of years. And he created what has become modern Europe. He created an educated class. He created a system of government, all through the force of his own personality. He would constantly go visit all the different parts of his empire to see that it was working well. One man, 6'4", with a mane of blonde hair and a big beard, constantly intimidating his people into doing what he wanted them to do, to create the empire that had been lost hundreds of years ago. It said that when they would have dinner at his court, they did not have jesters. You know what jesters are? The guys who were little clowns who entertained all the nobles who sat around the table eating. You know, it was like they didn't have television, so they needed something to watch while they were eating. And for most people, it was silly stuff. For Charlemagne, they would sit there and listen to the reading of the latest scholarly work that they had copied or found from ancient Rome, ancient Greece. So he was always learning. He had St. Augustine's works next to his bedside. He was a warrior scholar of the highest order. However, the strange thing is that he's mostly remembered for his one defeat. This man who fought 50 battles, conquered everything, became the new emperor. The story that we remember the most is a terrible, tragic defeat. It happened in the Pyrenees Mountains right there, see, between France and Spain. He had gone down there to fight the Muslims. Here's the Pyrenees Mountains. Take a good look now, because you're going to see something happen here. Nice and lovely and peaceful. Look how beautiful they are. But once upon a time, something happened that has been remembered by children of every century since then in Europe, called the Song of Roland. This is the first remembered story that was written down and carried down the centuries. Roland. So, just like Charlemagne, I want you to say it the French way, because this is my first hero. When I was your age, this is who I learned about. His name is Roland. Can you say Roland?
Roland.
Let me hear it. Roland. Roland was his nephew, they say, and he was one of his great fighters. And when they were coming back from Spain after another victory, the rear guard of this great army was headed up by Roland. So they were way behind Charlemagne and all the other soldiers. And at this spot, where today, if you go there, there's this monument, a remembrance of what happened so long ago. In one of the passes, mountain passes, this rear guard with Roland was attacked. The legend says by 100,000 men. The legend tells us it was Saracens, Muslims. The facts are that it was the mountain people of that area who wanted revenge on the destruction of one of their towns. So a terrible battle occurred where they were trapped in the mountains, and the rest of the army ahead of them and the great Charlemagne didn't know what was happening, and so they began to be killed, down to the last man. And Roland was one of the last ones. And you see him here trying to break his sword, because his sword was also a legendary sword. It had a name. Imagine a sword with a name. You've heard of Excalibur, maybe, from King Arthur. This was Durandal. And it was said that there was in the, the handle of the sword, was a tooth of St. Peter and blood of St. Basil and a thread from the Mother of God's cloak. So it was a very sacred sword, and the legend even says that it used to belong to Hector of Troy from the Iliad and the Odyssey. And so as the enemy was killing everyone and he was one of the last ones, he did not want that special sword, that magic sword, to end up in the hands of the enemy. So he tried to break it on the rocks, and it wouldn't break. So he had to hide it under his body as he lay dying. And there we see him in the famous moment when he blows a horn called an olifant that was made out of an elephant's tusk. He blows the horn to warn Charlemagne, that they're being killed. There he is, blowing his horn, desperately trying to contact them. And it is said that he blew it so powerfully that it burst the veins in his neck and in his temple, and that the sound went 8 miles across the mountains so that Charlemagne could hear it, could hear his nephew, letting him know that they were dying. And the story goes that, look at that, as he lay dying, he blows the horn again. It's weaker now, but you can still hear it over the mountain chains. But there was a traitor among them who told Charlemagne, oh, don't worry about it, he's just hunting. That's what he does when he's hunting, he blows that horn. And so Charlemagne didn't come until it was too late. And here's the classic picture of young Roland, the brave knight, faithfully blowing his horn to warn Charlemagne that his rear guard was destroyed, that they were all dying. This is the first picture I saw when I was your age. And this got embedded in my mind as the picture of the great hero. So what I want to do now for a moment is read to you from the actual Song of Roland, the legend that was written down and that for centuries was the source of inspiration for young men everywhere to go into battle or to be brave. It touched the hearts of children, parents, and even caused a national uproar in remembering Roland and how he died, because they died to the last man. So if you give me just a moment, I want you to hear this ancient song, this ancient story that was the first one ever written down as a tale long before King Arthur. So Roncevaux is the mountain pass where this happens. Listen now. To Roncevaux comes Charlemagne by and by. He sees the dead and tears come to his eyes. He tells the French, slowly, sirs, pray you ride. I would go first, alone, with none beside, for I would fain my nephew bodies find. Yonder at Aix, one festal day was I, and all about me stood valiant men of mine, boasting of battles and of their fiercest fights. Roland said something which now I call to mind, that should he come in foreign lands to die, beyond them all, footmen or peers, he'd lie, have his face turned to the enemy. Fighting he'd fall and finish victor-like. Before the rest, a staff's cast, or thereby the emperor goes and to a hilltop climbs. As the king goes, his nephew for to seek, how many flowers he finds upon the lea, red with blood of all our chivalry. He feels such pity he cannot choose but weep. This is Charlemagne, that big old tough guy, weeping. And now he reaches a place beneath two trees. There on three stones Count Roland's strokes he sees, and sees his nephew stretched on the grassy green. It is no wonder Charlemagne's woe is keen. Straight he dismounts and runs there on his feet. Between his hands he clasps the baron's cheeks, and swoons upon him, he is so wrung with grief. And it is said that to his final day, Charlemagne never got over the loss of his beloved Roland, who fought so bravely and tried to warn them. There is that famous horn that he blew and burst his veins trying to reach Charlemagne. Here's ancient pictures of Charlemagne finding him and that sword that he hid from the enemy, Durandal, that magic sword. And here's an amazing story. It is said that, another legend says that he threw the sword and it flew through the air and landed in a rock. And to this day, in a village nearby, you can see that rusty old sword stuck in a rock. And they say that is the sword of Roland. And here, remember that picture of him holding up the sword to try to break it? The legend is that that's what happened. That's called the Breach of Roland, where those two rocks are cut in half. That was created by his sword. So I'm going to give you another experience of this great tragedy, this story of Roland, in video form, just to give you one more sense of it. And I'll read the subtitles as we go through it. Roland of Roncevaux, that's the place. August 1778, Charlemagne's army came back to France after a tough campaign in Spain against the Moors. The bulk of the Frankish army, led by its king, crossed the Pyrenees without difficulty. Yet on August 15th, the rear guard was ambushed by Vasconi barbarians in the Roncevaux Pass. Frankish rear guard was annihilated during one of the very few military reverses of Charlemagne's reign. Although the royal annals of 770 AD did not relate this event, Einhard talked about it in his Vita Cavoli back then. He noted that several great Frankish lords had been killed at Roncevaux, among them the Count of the Palace, the prefect of the Breton March, Roland. 3 centuries later, this battle and this mysterious Roland were the topic of the first written work in Old French. The oldest known version was written in 1090. The Song of Roland, probably enriched by a long oral tradition, is a fascinating epic poem. Rough style and almost without. This is the masterpiece of the matter of France, a set of stories about the legendary feats of Charlemagne. Written during the Crusades to Castile, Spain, the song changes historical facts and has the Franks opposed to Muslim Moors rather than the barbarians. Roland is said to have been betrayed and helped the army of Saracen King Marsile to attack the Frankish rear guard. Despite his friends Olivier's supplications, the proud Roland refuses, calling Charlemagne for help. Therefore, the outnumbered Franks are destroyed. Please to God and his saint angel that by me France does not lose its glory. Death rather than shame, Roland shouts. During a Herculean combat, Frankish knights die one after another, not without causing many casualties to the enemy. The last surviving one fatally wounded, Roland resolves to blow his olifant after he kills Marsile. The story ends with the implacable revenge of Charlemagne who destroys the Saracen army. Forces Marsile's wife to convert to Christianity and has Ganelon quartered. You can barely imagine how popular the Song of Roland was in the Kingdom of France in the 11th and 12th centuries. The French chose the warlike Roland as their national hero rather than the wise Olivier, his friend. Let me show you this last shot. This song was used for William the Conqueror just before the Battle of Hastings to encourage the soldiers. Be brave like him. He became the example to follow for the Crusades in the Holy Land. And those are statues of him in different countries. And pilgrims on their way to Santiago de Compostela often stop right there to remember this. And there's that sword I told you about that he throws and is chained to the mountain wall. Centuries, this story goes on, and you heard me say that he was the hero held up for the Crusades, which were a terrible time of bloodshed in human history. So this one man's bravery became a model for countless knights and soldiers down through the centuries. Did you hear that his friend Olivier in the battle urged him to blow that horn for Charlemagne to come and save them, and he refused to the last minute because he didn't want them to come back and be attacked also by the barbarians. So instead he chose to fight to the death and preserve Charlemagne. Never forgot that bravery. So there's an ancient picture of Charlemagne over his body. You know, this is the result of warfare, tragedy and grief, as well as empire building. But as I said, Charlemagne went on to create schools and a world that we are the descendants of. There would have been no Europe without this amazing man. He brought the great scholar Alcuin from England to be in his court to teach his children. And he continued to be the protector of the Western Church. And because this is mostly for children, I won't go into the complicated details of something known as the filioque, which Charlemagne believed. I will say this, is somewhat controversial, I guess, but we can't be here in Orthodox Church and not make the point that the Great Schism of 1054 started in 800 AD with Charlemagne and the theologians that he gathered at his court and his own issues and prejudices. He wanted the Eastern Roman Empire. He wanted Byzantium. He wanted to recreate the whole empire. In fact, he tried to marry the Empress Irene to consolidate, and it didn't work out. And it is said that he referred to the Christians of the East as those Greeks. It was the beginning of a prejudice that made Orthodoxy second class to the Western Frankish Roman version. This was the beginning of the Roman Catholic Church. The Frankish tribes were Arian. It's a question whether Charlemagne was an iconoclast. But what was clear was that he favored the Pope in the West over against the East, and his views and his desire to have one empire was the beginning of what led to the terrible break between East and West, of which we are the victims and descendants of. It's ironic that most all of us here are Western converts to Orthodoxy. It shows the miracle of what that means, because from the days of Charlemagne, what are we talking about, you know, 1,000 years plus, there was such a total break with the East that we had no access to what we know to be the fullness of Christianity. And it began in his era with his leadership, with the radical shift of power and the different theologies and mindsets. It's the beginning of rationalism, humanism, the Enlightenment, all of that which created Western thinking, Catholic thinking, versus that of the Holy Fathers. So that is the other piece of his legacy that we, when I was a French boy learning this, we never heard that part. We only heard how great he was, starting schools and all of that, and creating new Christians. We didn't hear that part about walling off the origins of Christianity. So I leave you with that reality and that phenomenon, that while the West praises this amazing individual who pulled the world out of the Dark Ages, he also initiated that which created the Roman Catholic Church and later Protestantism, and left us here in America bereft until we could find our way back home into the deep teachings. One last thing, this is his chapel, Aix-la-Chapelle in northern Germany. You'll notice that if you look closely, it's got a very Byzantine feel. It was his effort to create a small Byzantium, and there's his actual throne that you can go look at, probably not sit in, but look at it. To this day, he was not a luxurious man. He was very approachable, and you know, he didn't believe in pomp and circumstance, but he created this so to create a capital, a stable place from which he could rule his empire, you see that? And essentially take it away from Constantinople. So that is Charlemagne, Charles the Great, who created Europe as we know it, and so much of the education that came down to those of us who were formed there. Next week, we will be studying the life of this person. Anybody guess who this is? Who do you think this is? Saint Helena. As in Saint Constantine and Helena. This is Saint Constantine's mother, Helena, who found the Holy Cross and played such an important role in the fullness of Christianity and its acceptance in the world. An amazing saint and lady. We'll meet her next week. Thank you so very much for your attention. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. I hope you learned something. Yeah.
So that last church place you showed, where was that?
It's in Aachen, A-A-C-H-E-N, Germany. But it's got a French name, strange enough, Aix-la-Chapelle. And it was his primary chapel, church, his home, where he died. And the center of his power.
So where's the, was it before or after where Rome became the place for the popes and all that?
Well, that actually, he initiated the new power of the popes, right? He became the protector of popes. He reestablished their lands and protected them from the Lombards in Italy and opened the way to the power of the popes. And the popes then began to confuse priestly and kingly roles, which then led to Roman Catholicism as we know it. All of that because Charlemagne stabilized things, gave them power, and set up this new world, this new institution in which they could rule, forgetting the Eastern Christians.
So it was after they eventually went to Rome and made that the Vatican?
That's right, later on. Yeah. This is the early stages, coming out of the dark, laying the groundwork for what became the future of the Western world.
So was there still a headquarters in Byzantine Constantinople and all that still there?
At the time, yes, there was. But they were more and more cut off. You know, the Eastern Christians made the mistake to just assume this was the barbarian Franks making trouble, so it was no big deal. They didn't realize the significance of what was happening that would eventually eclipse their role in Christendom and sort of make them backwater peoples to the West, which before that was unthinkable because it was all one church. So you can imagine complications that came from that. Protestantism reacting against the Catholic Church, knowing nothing about the Eastern Church, and all the sects that have come down to us that sort of created America thinking, was all due to this shifting of power base and the theology that was initiated by Charlemagne and his court of scholars and his sort of anti-Byzantine mindset. It's, as Father David said the other day when we were talking about this, it's good to be able to connect the dots, to understand how did Baptists end up representing Christianity in our country so strongly, and you can actually trace it all back to Charlemagne in the early days of the breakup of the church.
Where you're talking about Charlemagne establishing schools and libraries and that, wasn't it the libraries of the in Spain after the fall of Toledo and that, and all of those ancient texts that made it through the Dark Ages, that was kind of the blossoming of, you know, it's like you fall into an encyclopedia. It's all there. You just have to translate it from Arabic. Wasn't there a big surge in scholarly texts being translated back to French from in Spain?
That is correct. He didn't have to do the heavy lifting. He just had to create the power base and the central government and bring all that in and have it accessible to people in languages they could read. So there's a whole scholarship about how the sort of pagan knowledge that was preserved through Spain came back to the fore through Charlemagne, created the way of thinking of Europe, which has come down to us to this day. Scholasticism, you know, all of that was influenced by the direction that they went once they were placed in power and had access to these materials without the wisdom of the Holy Fathers. Like I say, it's controversial because the good part is that it was civilization coming back to the fore. The dark side is that it was at the expense of the influence of the Byzantine world and Christianity from the origins.